Wow, here we are again with tidbits from the Word. Brother Peter here. Before you start, I would suggest you get you a pad and a pen and the Bible and put it out. And you probably won't have time to write down some of the things. But if you have your Bible with you, why, you'll be able to do it. Now, we're going to start out by saying in 1969, many revelations were given to me. And to other preachers too, but Romans 13 and 7, that it said, we're going to talk about self. What about yourself? You're supposed to live to the Lord and die to the Lord. But in 1969, I lived for me and for myself, and I would have died and went to hell. But in 1972, God saw fit to save me at 3 o'clock in the morning. Drunk and a wicked man, had been drinking all night, playing poker and everything, and I wrecked my car and I got out, and God said, your number's up. I said, Lord, I'm a sinner. Forgive me of my sin. Come in my heart and save my soul. He did. So where do we stand now? We stand now before the Lord. Daily I stand before the Lord. He is in me. I am in him. And I am in communion with him. Although now the old flesh and the old man has been put away. The Bible calls it, die unto the old man. So the old man is to be dead. Jesus Christ, the Lord, came into me. He is the one that's supposed to be in front of everything. His name, God. Jesus is God in the flesh. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost were three. God sent his Son to the earth to be ruler over everything. God was ruler over everything. Jesus was with God when everything was created. Now he is ruler over everything. But he is the best thing he does for you and I as people is he opens our eyes to the fact that we are blind to his spirit and his spirit world, the spiritual realm, when we're living in sin like I was. And so he opened my eyes. And since then, I've already seen the glory of God in my life. And just not being able to get up in the morning and take a drink. Just not being able to get up and curse and swear and ravel and do things and slam out of the house and do all kinds of things. And I had a good enough wife to stay with me during those periods of time. We see in Jesus as he walked on the earth, we see him raising Lazarus from the dead. Lazarus was in the grave 3 days already, and Jesus raised him from the dead as an example that in 3 days he was going to be raised from the dead. He gave everybody a picture of what was going to happen with himself. And he told people, I'm going to die on the cross. They're going to put me in the grave. And in 3 days, I'm coming out. And people would say, can a man live after 3 days? Lazarus did. He raised Lazarus up. And he did that. And then he was walking one day. As he was walking, these guys, two guys that were in Gadara, came out of the grave saying, Jesus, we know who thou art. If you cast us out, cast us into the herd of swine. And Jesus said, okay, go. That was what he said, go. And they went into the herd of swine. And the swine ran down the mountain into the water and drowned in the water. And those two guys sat back up and said, what happened? What happened? And Jesus said, you now have me in you and not that spirit anymore. So let's look back at Jesus as he goes. He is the Lord and he is the Savior. And he saved. His saving is like getting married. When you ask Jesus to forgive you of your sin, come in your heart and save your soul, that's like when you get married. You say, forever, forever, I love you. Forever, we'll do it. This is a bond forever. And when you say, I do, to Jesus when he comes out to you, it is a forever thing. You receive all that you need at that moment. But the thing is you haven't learned how to use all that you need yet. So you increase. The Spirit of Jesus Christ will help you increase. Where have you got to stay to increase? In the book, in the Word, in the Word. And he is now a resident within you. And by being that resident and being the superiority that he is, he needs to be the ruler of your life. And he will present himself as Master and Lord of your life if you will give it to him. If you can continue to take it, he won't come forward to the front. You push him back down. So you must always give it to him. See, when you received him, that's all you're going to get. You're not going to get any more. You can grow in the Lord and increase, but you won't grow any more in the salvation. Salvation is it once you get it. Now, the Savior that saved you, he is now your representative. And he is now ruler of your life. He is now the president, if you please, of everything that you do. He is also, not just that, but he is the master and Lord of your life. And that's what he's supposed to be. How do you get him? By action. Action is how you have Jesus grow in you. He'll grow in you by action. If you will do the action for him. And what is action? That's that you might lift the Lord up in your life. Get in his book called the Bible, the B-I-B-L-E, God's book. And I believe that the King James Version is the best one to get into if you want the total truth and nothing but the truth. And he's raising you, by the way. When he came in, he raised you from the dead. Now he's keeping you alive. And now that you are alive, that you might have the life of God show outwardly from what he's given you inwardly. He's given it to you in with a price. You were bought with a price. What was that price? That Jesus went to the cross. He went to the cross just like a bond slave did. Beside him were two thieves. That were, and one was a murderer and one was a thief beside him. And he was put in the same context as they were. He died, though, and rose for our sakes. We talked a minute ago about him raising Lazarus in 3 days, and he raised in 3 days. Let him be Lord of your life. I have made him Lord of my life, and the light of him shines through me, and I have to allow that. And do you want Jesus to give without you giving back? No. If Jesus gives to you, you need to give back. You need to give him yourself and give him your life and say, I will do Jesus for you. Well, Sunday morning comes and you don't feel like getting up and going to church. You say, man, I got up and went to work every day this week. I'm going to lay in bed this morning. No, you get yourself up and go to church. This is the confidence that you'll have within your own self that Jesus has come in and has given you what you need. And you need to live in him. That's called righteousness. You will be clothed with the righteousness of God, where before you were clothed with the evil and the wickedness of the devil. So, when they heard in Genesis 3 and 7, when they heard the sound, they hid themselves. Adam and Eve, when they heard the sound of God coming in the garden, they hid themselves because they had sinned. You and I, now we've asked Jesus into our heart. When we sin, we kind of hide away from opening the Bible and getting into it. We hide away from going to church. We don't show up first one Sunday, then two Sundays, then three Sundays. and we're not willing to admit that sin. And so you can't hide the fact that you have sin in your life. If you have sin in your life, it'll show up by your actions. You won't be doing things of God if you have this sin. And then in the good graces of God, back into the good graces of God, you show up in His presence. You say, God, forgive me. I have sinned. I need you to help me now. There are 40 chapters. If you put all of the speaking of sin in the Bible, it would make up 40 chapters in the Bible. And the holy bread of God, the Lamb of God, and the inside, the spirits, the bronzen altar, the brazen altar, the open court, the veil, the things that all of the children of Israel had to do in order to get God's audience. All you have to do is say, God, forgive me. I slept in Sunday because I was lazy. Can you forgive me of that? Help me not to do that anymore. And get back yourself, get yourself back right. And remember that the bulk of the Bible speaks against sin. And so we saw there was an outer court in the tabernacle. The Old Testament people had to come into the outer court and sacrifice. And then they could get into the inner court. Jesus did the sacrificing for you and I. And so now we don't have to do that work like they had to do. We now have Him in us and us in Him. And so we can do that. So, when remember we spoke a minute ago about the Lord driving those devils out of those men. And He did the same for you and I when we asked Him to come into our heart and forgive us of our sins. Verse 7 said that one of the promises of God in the book of Hebrews, in verse 7, verse 9, it said, for Adam to Jesus, from Adam to Jesus, everything has been taken care of by Jesus. He forgave all of the past. But from Adam to Jesus, they were living by that law I was just speaking about a minute ago, where they had to go into the tabernacle, into the place of the Holy of Holies. Our confidence is in God and in Jesus alone. We don't have to come and do obligations. The reason we do obligations, we do go out and visit people, we do God's work. The reason we do that is because He did save us, and we love Him for that. So, we find out how to live in the confidence of God is to live as close to Jesus as we possibly can live in our life. Our devotion is what keeps the devil away from us. If we follow Jesus close enough, we will be able to overcome that tempter. And it's, our performance is not what makes us closer to Jesus. He loves us even when we fail in our performance. But the thing about it is He would like us to perform closer to Him. Remember now, every day the accuser of you is the devil. He's accusing God every time you do something. And all things that life in life. So we do need to pray. We do need to get in the Bible. We do need to study. We need Bible study. We need witnessing. We need all kinds of things. But those aren't what keep us safe. What keeps us saved is Jesus Christ. Even though if you didn't do those things, you'd be saved. But you won't have the spiritual life that you could have. So what do we look at here? In Matthew 5 and 12, we see the confidence that we have in God And in Matthew 27, we see the provision that we have from God. And as we go on down through the book of Matthew, we see he gives a way for us to live by him. We see over then from Matthew, jump all the way over to the book of John, and we can read why he's done this. One reason is so that we escape hell. Hell is a place of the damned. Hell is a place of total separation. Hell is the place of total misery. Hell is the place of eternal separation from all our loved ones, yet we will have them all in our mind, but we will be eternally separated from them, even if they are in hell. Another thing we find out about in Matthew 27:38, in darkness, and 44, that hell is darkness. It is total darkness. It's eternal darkness. You know, darkness terrifies people. You put a man in total darkness. Put him in a box with total darkness. The least little thing terrifies him. You could just scratch on the box just a little bit, and he'd be terrified. And you start beating on the box, and he'll have a heart attack. That's how terrified he'll be. That's what hell is like. Only thing is, you can't die in hell. You can't get away from it. You can't get away from anything. Yet it's in total darkness. And Jesus said, when he was on the cross, and you remember, for 3 hours it became total darkness. And Jesus said, "My God, my God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" And God had to forsake him because of while he went through that death process of the body. Why did he have to go through a bodily death process? To show us that God is going to raise us after we die. When Lazarus died, Jesus allowed him to lay in the grave for 3 days. And he allowed him to die, by the way. He could have not. He could have kept him from dying. But he didn't. He let him die. Go to the grave. And for 3 days, they had beckoned Jesus to come. And Jesus said, "I can't go. Because this is a purpose. God has a purpose for Lazarus dying and going to the grave so Jesus could raise him on the third day." Now, in the Old Testament, we can go back to the Old Testament and see something that was there that Jesus took away. In the Old Testament, there was a veil. That veil was 40 feet high. It was 13 inches thick. It was woven in such a way that you could have put all of the elephants on one side, all the oxen of the world, or all the heavy beasts of the world on the other side, and put chains on that thing, and they could have pulled until they dropped dead and not even stretched the thing. There was no way to tear it. It was made indestructible. And God knew how to tell them. He told them how to make it. 13 inches thick now, woven both ways, this way and that way, woven inside and outside, woven together from side to side, either way, and from end to end. And it could not be torn in any way, shape, or form. When Jesus said on the cross, "It is finished," the veil was rent in two. My picture of that is, when Jesus said it's finished, he left that cross, he went down straight through that veil, and that veil was no longer in use. That never could be used again. The veil was what kept people from looking at the Holy of Holies, which was behind the veil, and that was the place of the Holy of Holies. Now we come directly to God, to the Holy of Holies, through his Son, Jesus Christ, in heaven. All that was in there from the Old Testament is now gone to heaven. Not just before, but for us. in his presence. Wow. And that's what Jesus was showing us. So, just for us, not with the blood of bulls and goats, or not with the blood of other human beings, but with the blood of Jesus Christ only, that veil was rent. Hebrews 10:19 said, now we have confidence. Now we have boldness. Now we can come directly to the foot of the cross and the foot of Christ and say, here I am, Lord. I'm a sinner that needs saving. Forgive me of my sin. Come in and save my soul. I did that. November 5th, 3 o'clock in the morning, 1972. And God came in my heart and saved me. And now I have the boldness that he's given me. Hebrews 9-12. Not with the blood of bulls and goats, but with the glory of the blood, shed blood of Jesus Christ, which washed away all sins from the world. All of those that will put their trust in him. Hebrews 10:19. Confidence. This is, again, that word confidence is boldness to come before Jesus Christ. So we can draw nigh to him, and he will draw nigh to us. Chapter 4 of Hebrews. Confidence, one sacrifice for all. Jesus was one sacrifice for all. Verse 16, he said, so let us therefore with confidence be hid in him. So from now on, if you want to stay close to God, you just have your confidence in him.